Hello students, welcome back to the channel. It feels great to have you all, and I believe you all are enjoying and utilizing your lockdown productively. Today we are going to take up another topic from the subject civics, that is the president and the vice president. In the previous video we had discussed about the Union Parliament and had in detail studied about the Lok Sabha, the Rajya Sabha, their powers, their functions. So today we are going to see how the president is an important part of the Union Parliament of India. We will be discussing about the qualifications of the post of a president as well as the powers and the functions for president. Apart from that, we will be discussing about the vice president, his role and his term of office. So let us start with the topic for the day. So who is a president? President is head of a state as per the constitution. It means that no law in the nation can be passed without his assent, that is without his approval. Also, he is the executive head of the Union of India. He controls the executive function of the nation and also time to time works with the advice of the Prime Minister and the Council of the ministers in order to ensure that the administration of the country is very smooth and the welfare objective of the nation is achieved. He is also termed to be as the first citizen of the country, that is whoever becomes a president, he becomes the first citizen of the country. Apart from that, he exercises functions as per the advice of the Council of Ministers, which is headed by the Prime Minister. So once the Prime Minister is selected, he forms his own government, that is by choosing certain members from the houses as the Council of Ministers. These ministers, they have specialized knowledge with respect to particular departments. So they all together provide the information to the president, which helps him exercise his necessary functions as per mentioned in the constitution. The president is not directly elected by the people, but there is an indirect elections wherein an electoral college votes, and the system of such voting is called as proportional representation by single transferable vote. We are going to discuss about this in detail in the further topic. Apart from that, the current president of India is Mr. Ramnath Kovind, and it is very essential for the students to be aware with respect to the political dynamics of the country. They also must have sufficient information about the leaders, that is Prime Minister, President and all the other ministers having various positions. Now let us move ahead with the next topic, that is who is eligible for the election of the President. As per the Constitution of India, certain criteria has been determined for a candidate to contest the election of a President. Let us look at the qualifications. First, it states that he or she must be a citizen of India. As we have learned in the previous lecture about the Union Parliament, we've seen that for any member to become a part of Parliament, it is essential for he or she to be a citizen. So same applies for the president also. The minimum age for an individual to contest election as a president is 35 years of age. We saw that in case of Lok Sabha it was 25, in case of Rajya Sabha it was 30, and now in case of president it is 35. You need to be well aware with the ages and also learn it thoroughly. Next, he or she should be qualified to be a member of Lok Sabha. We have discussed the qualifications of Lok Sabha as well. That is, the person should not be of unsound mind, should not be insolvent, or should not be disqualified as per the various provisions laid down in the constitution. Now, why is it essential for the president to be qualified for Lok Sabha and not Rajya Sabha? The reason being is that the process of election of the president is indirect, but the leaders or the framers of the constitution always wanting to strengthen the democratic ideals, and therefore the president, if is qualified for the Lok Sabha, means that is well qualified to seek votes from the public directly, from the people directly, and that is the basic principle of democracy. And therefore a person or a candidate who is willing to contest the post of the president must be well qualified to be a member of Lok Sabha. Next, he or she should not hold any office of profit under the government. This also I had discussed, that the major objective of the government or the parliament is establishing the social welfare of the people. And if any of the candidate, irrespective of any of the position, if has any office of profit or has any personal interest, it is definitely going to conflict with our welfare objective, and that is going to break the basic principles or ideals of the constitution. For whoever follows or fulfills the given criteria is said to be eligible for the post of president. Now let us see what exactly is an indirect election, or how does the election of the president take place. First of all, the candidate who is willing to be a president must be proposed by at least 50 members of either of the house. That is, at least 50 members of any house must propose or must give a proposal for that person's candidature. Once that proposal is placed in the house, another 50 members must second it, that is support the proposal. If the candidate gets enough support, then he is further promoted to the second step, wherein he has to deposit rupees 15,000 as security. The reason being is that earlier, when there was no security or the security amount was low, every candidate could apply for the post, and which led to undermining the position of a president, because every individual, whether serious or not, wanted to just try their luck. So this kind of deteriorated the position, and therefore the parliament decided to keep a security amount of rupees 15,000, and the ones who are actually serious may definitely contest the election for the post of the president. Next, once the candidates are selected, the electoral college votes. Now this voting takes place through a process called as proportional representation through a single transferable vote. What this system is, I'm going to explain it in detail in the further part of the video. Once the electoral college is formed, they vote. The voting is done through a secret ballot, that is, it is not announced upfrontly, and the candidate who gets the majority of vote or gets more than 50% of the vote is declared as the president. Each of the member has a different value of the vote, which is calculated by a certain formula, and that I'll be explaining it to you. Also, keep noting the points essential which I've mentioned in the video, so it becomes easier for you to frame the answers later. Now, what is an electoral college? So, electoral college is a body of electors who vote for a candidate for the position of a president. It's just like, say for example, in case of general election, all the people of the age 18 and above, they vote. So this whole population who is 18 or above is called as a body of electors. Similarly, the people who vote for the position of the president is called as its electoral college. Electoral college consists of the elected members of both the houses of the parliament, that is the elected members of Lok Sabha and the Rajya Sabha. It does not include the nominated members, that is the two nominated members of Anglo-Indian community and the 12 nominated members of Rajya Sabha are not included in the electoral college. Apart from that, it also includes elected members of legislative assemblies of the states, and including the National Capital Territory Delhi and the Union Territory Puducherry. Even in case of Delhi and Puducherry, only the elected members are the part of electoral college and not the nominated members, because these nominated members are nominated by the president. Thus, only the elected members who are elected by the people of the country are allowed to vote for the president. So therefore, it kind of involves indirectly the population of the country and the eligible voters. Now let us have a look at the procedure of elections, or what is a proportional representation through a single transferable vote. Here, single means that every member of the houses of the parliament or the legislative assemblies, or in short the electoral college, is allowed to make only one vote, and in that case he gives voting as per the preference. So for example, if there are three representatives, I may mark 1, 2, 3 according to my preference. So similarly, every member of the electoral college does it in the same manner, and the candidate who receives one maximum number of times, or more than 50%, becomes the president. And in case of no majority, then the third, the one who has received third preferential vote maximum number of times, is transferred to the remaining two candidates. So this is a process of a single transferable vote. What we mean by proportional representation? Now, since we including state legislative assemblies also and the houses of parliament, we know that neither of this house or legislative assembly have equal number of ministers. That is the reason we have tried to involve equality in the presentation by determining the value of vote separately. It means that the state which has majority of the population will have comparatively larger value of vote of their ministers compared to the states which has lesser population. So this ensures that every state or every union territory or every house gets an equality in their representation, as the president is the executive head, and head must be represented by all the sections or all the states and all the union territories equally. Now the value of the vote is calculated by a certain formula. As you can see, first of all, the population of a state is calculated, and then it is divided by the total number of elected MLAs, that is the member of legislative assemblies, and whatever answer you get is further divided by 1000. So let us take an hypothecated example. Say the population of Maharashtra is 10,000 and the total number of elected MLAs are 2. So here 10,000 divided by 2 gives you 5,000. Now here again we are going to divide it by 1000, so the value we get is 5. It means that every member of the Legislative Assembly of Maharashtra will have the value of its vote as 5. Once we calculate the value of vote for every MLAs in the country, that is including the state and union territory of Delhi and Puducherry, we sum it up and we get the total value of votes of all the elected MLAs. Next step is we calculate the value of vote of an MP, that is a member of parliament of the houses. So once we get the total value, we divide them with the total number of elected MP, that is a member of parliament. So say after taking all the states, say Maharashtra has value 5, Uttar Pradesh has 7, etc. By doing all of this, I get 1 lakh. And say assume total number of elected members or member of parliament are 10. So here automatically I get 1 lakh divided by 10. Answer I get is 10,000. So it means the value of every member of the parliament is 10,000. Now here this was an hypothecated example. So this is not the actual value, but this was just to show how the calculations take place. I hope now you are clear with the complete process as to how the elections take place for the position of president, called as indirect elections. Now moving ahead to the oath of office. Oath of office is wherein the president, in front of the Chief Justice of India, or say in the absence of Chief Justice of India, or the senior most judge of the Supreme Court, takes an oath and affirms to follow and perform its functions and to uphold the provisions of the Constitution and maintain sovereignty and integrity of the country. The oath includes the following. that is, discharge the functions of the President of India with a complete honesty, and to preserve and protect, defend the Constitution and the law of the nation, and devote himself to the service and well-being of the people of India. So the President has to always keep in mind that he has to work for the welfare of the country, and nowhere his personal interest should conflict with this objective. If it is found that the President violates any of the constitutional law or acts against the Constitution, then he can be removed by the process of impeachment. The process of impeachment is explained in detail in the further part of the video. Now we will look at the term of the office. Term of the office means the duration under which the President holds his position or the office. The President holds the office for a term of 5 years from the date he enters the office. So once a President is elected, he continues the position for a period of 5 years. After that, he can apply for the position again and can be re-elected as the President. Before the completion of the term, that is 5 years, also the President may resign by submitting his resignation to the Vice President of India. In case the President's position becomes vacant, it may be due to illness or it may be due to his resignation or death, the Vice President takes the charge and he continues to perform all the function or discharge all the duties as a President. But the seat cannot be vacant for a period of more than 6 months. Therefore, the elections of the President needs to be conducted soon, and that is within a period of 6 months. And the President, as I told you, can also be removed by a process of impeachment. So in that case also, the seat becomes vacant. The President may take a charge temporarily. Heard about the word impeachment many a time, so let us see what this impeachment process is. So this impeachment process is a series of steps which are involved before removing the President from his post, because President holds a very high position as per the Constitution, and therefore it cannot be very easy to remove him, and therefore certain steps are involved, and let us see what those steps are in detail. If any of the member or group of members feel that the constitutional provisions have been violated, or the Constitution has been violated by the conduct of the President, they can initiate a proceedings in either of the house. Before passing any resolution or voting in favor or against the resolution, a 14 days notice has to be given to the President, is to acknowledge him that certain proceedings have been initiated on certain charges, and opportunity should be given to the President to justification for his conduct or any of the decisions which the members feel are in violation of the Constitution. Is given to the President must be signed by at least 1/4 of the members of the house in which the proceedings have been initiated. That is, not a single member can proceed against the President, and the charges also should be mentioned. Post the period of 14 days, the resolution is moved, that is, it is placed in the house for the voting, and if 2/3 of the majority of the house votes in the favor of this resolution, then the resolution is passed to the other house. There also the house can investigate and initiate the proceedings, and may give reasonable opportunity to the President to explain or justify the charges. And if the house feels that a misconduct has taken place, the house can pass the resolution again by 2/3 of the majority. And the moment the second house votes with a 2/3 majority, the resolution stands passed and the President stands impeached. And it feels proud to state that in India so far, no President has been impeached, and all of the Presidents successfully been performing their duties or discharging their functions and maintaining the integrity of the country. We all know that the president is having a very high position and is entrusted with lot of powers as mentioned in the constitution. There are different kinds of powers which a president has. There are legislative powers, executive powers, judicial, military, emergency, financial and discretionary powers. The president exercises these powers and ensures that the lawmaking process and the other function of the parliament takes place smoothly and ensures that the parliamentary procedures take place without any interruptions. Many a times we feel that in case of any foreign meetings or gatherings, different countries are represented by their presidents. But in case of our country, we see that our prime minister represents our nation. So we tend to think, why is it so that other countries have their president and we have our prime minister representing us? Is that our prime minister has more powers or is that our president has more powers? We will clear that by looking at the powers of the president in detail. But let me make it clear that in India, the president is considered to be a nominal head, whereas the prime minister is the one who exercises the real power. That is, whatever the president acts or the way he performs, he does it on the advice of the prime ministers and the council of ministers. So directly or indirectly, the decisions of the president are influenced by the prime minister. So in short, that both of them have their own powers and functions to be performed by the constitution and they're interrelated. But yes, president exercises his powers on the advice of the prime minister. Is the reason we generally think that in India, prime minister is more powerful than that of president. The constitution also states that president is the one who elects the prime minister or may also on his advice dissolve the Lok Sabha or remove the prime minister and his council of ministers in case of no confidence motion. So if that is the case, we cannot say that only the prime minister is more powerful and the president is less. Both of them are powerful, but since the prime minister is directly elected by the people, the prime minister has more accountability and always has to represent the nation and also communicate with the people time to time. It is the absolute beauty of the Indian constitution that it has created different positions considering the requirement of the nation, the expectation, aspirations of the people, and it also represents the mindset and the objective of our leaders or the framers of the constitution. Now, what are the legislative powers of the president and the financial powers? Let us look at them in detail. First is that he or she can address the parliament at the beginning of the first session of the year. That is, when a new Lok Sabha is created post the elections, the first meeting is addressed by the president, wherein they state the objectives and the missions of the government and how they are going to carry their welfare objective. Also, every year, the first session is addressed by the president. That is, in the period of 5 years, when the Lok Sabha commences its session, that is, the first is the budget session, the first meeting under that is addressed by the president. Second legislative power states that he or she can send message to either of the house on important subject matter. The president can anytime seek any information or send any message to either of the house when he feels that the subject matter is of great importance and he needs to exercise his functions or make certain decisions. So he may seek the information anytime from the parliament or the houses. Next is dissolve the Lok Sabha and power to summon and prorogue the house. In case where a no confidence motion is passed in the house with majority, that means that the ministers or the members do not have much confidence in the leadership of the president, then the president can dissolve the house and he may also ask the leader of the opposition to contest and come on the floor and test his majority. Apart from that, the president can also summon, it means that he may demand or place an order for a joint session, which means summon. So he may demand for a joint session on a particular bill which is not being passed due to conflicts between either of the houses, or for any of the other address, he may call for a joint session. And prorogue the house means put an end to a particular session of the house. All of these powers are exercised by the president. He has another power, that is nominating members, 12 in case of Rajya Sabha and 2 in case of Lok Sabha. We've read and we've understood that in case of the Union Parliament, that the president nominates 12 members in the Rajya Sabha on the basis of literature or their skill on social service or science, etc. And in case of Lok Sabha, 2 people are nominated from the Anglo-Indian community. If we feel that the community is not represented fairly, then the president can nominate them to the house. Next is that no bill can become a law without his or her assent. Yes, this is so true that no bill can turn into a law unless the president puts his assent. That is, once the bill is passed by either of the house, the president can put his assent and turn it into a law, or may also refuse to provide his assent and recommend some changes or modification and send the bill back to the house. The house may either accept the recommendation of the president or may not, and again pass the bill and send it to the president. When the president receives the bill with or without the modification for the second time, at this time he has to pass the bill or provide his assent, and he cannot refuse to provide his assent. And this is a biggest power of the president, that is turning a bill into a law. Also, next is some bills may be reserved by the governor for his or her assent. Now, the governor holds a similar position like a president in case of state legislative assemblies. So there may be some bills which the governor feels that is beyond the powers or authority of the legislative assemblies and may hold it for the president's assent. So some bills of the legislative assemblies are also turned into law by the assent of the president, and that is, he indirectly exercises his control in some areas in the state legislative assemblies. And the most important is pass ordinances. Ordinances are laws which are passed by the president without any procedure of passing it via the houses. Now, how does it happen? There are times wherein there is emergency and the law should be made on the subject matter immediately, but the houses may not be in the session, or only one house may be in the session. So at that time, waiting can be injurious for the peace or the public tranquility. So at that time, the president passes the law on recommendation of the president and the council of ministers, and this ordinance remains in force for a period of 6 months. And once the houses are back in their office or back to their businesses, this ordinance is placed on the table. If the houses accept the ordinances with or without modification, then it turns into an act or a law. And in case if the parliament feels that it is not appropriate or the ordinance cannot be continued, then the ordinance is rejected. So ordinance is a kind of a short-term law which is passed by the president considering the emergency or the public tranquility, and it has the same force as to the act or the bill passed by either of the house through a normal procedure. So this was all the legislative powers exercised by the president. Now let us look at the financial powers. President introduces the annual budget every year in the parliament. That is, every year when the budget is prepared, it is first being approved by the president and his recommendation is sought. And once the budget is prepared, approval or assent needs to be taken from the president to withdraw the funds from the Contingency Fund of India. So Contingency Fund of India is like a bank account, account wherein all the revenues of the government is deposited. That may be in the form of taxes or revenue from other sources by selling public goods, etc. And next is recommendation from introducing money bill in the parliament. So money bill, as we discussed again in the Union Parliament, is different from that of ordinary bill, and it can only be introduced in the Lok Sabha.
Money bill includes certain changes in the taxation policy or main change in the form of the revenues or expenditure, etc. So this money bill also requires the recommendation of the president, and he may suggest certain modifications depending upon the circumstances. So these are all the financial and the legislative powers exercised by the president, and which directly or indirectly facilitate the functioning of the parliament. Ahead to the judicial and the military powers. Judicial powers are as follows. The president has a power to appoint the CJI, that is the Chief Justice of India, and the judges of the Supreme Court and the High Court. The judges are appointed considering their judicial experience and also their performance over the years. In case of the judges of Supreme Court and High Court, the advice of the Chief Justice of India is also taken by the president. Next is power to grant pardon, respite, remission, etc. Now, Supreme Court is the highest authority or the judicial authority of the country. But once the decision is made by the Supreme Court can also not change its decision. So at that time, the person on whom a penalty or a punishment is imposed may seek for pardon, respite and remission from the president. That is, president can grant pardon, means a complete relief from the punishment or the charge. Respite is a relief or a transformation in the form of a punishment. Remission is reduction in the punishment. That is, if a person is sentenced for a period of 10 years, then the punishment may be reduced to 5 or 4, etc. So all of these powers is exercised by the president under the judicial power. And no criminal suit can be instituted against the president during his tenure. So this is also a judicial power. That is, any of the criminal suit or any of the criminal proceedings have to wait until the president completes his term or a tenure, and post that only criminal proceedings can be instituted and cannot be instituted during his term of office. So this was all about the judicial power. Now let us look at the military powers. He or she is the supreme commander of the Defense Forces of India. Defense forces are three, that is the Army, Navy and Air Force. So all of these have their supreme commander as the president, and they perform the functions or they act as per the directions of the president. Also, the president appoints the chief of the Army, Navy and the Air Force, who take care of the departments, and president approves if necessary to declare the war. That is, war cannot be declared without the approval of the president. So this also shows that he has a great role in the defense of the country and also regulates their functions. Now we will be moving ahead with the executive and the discretionary powers. Executive and discretionary powers are as follows. Executive states that head of the union administration and all the executive orders are issued in his or her name. So administration means basically managing all the activities of the country, and any of the orders which are issued are under his name. That shows that he has a great authority, and no order can be executed without his assent. Next is, he appoints the prime ministers and the governor of the states. So the prime minister is appointed by the president. We have already discussed about this. And also the governors, which are similar to that of a president for state, is also appointed by the president. President may or may not appoint one governor for two or more states. So it depends upon his discretion. And next, he appoints lieutenant governor for the union territories. In case of union territories, since their functioning is different from that of state, they do not have governors, but they have lieutenant governors, and they are appointed by the president. Now let us see about the discretionary powers. In case of no party gaining majority, president can use his discretion and appoint the prime minister. This happens when, after the voting or the general elections, we find that none of the political party has at least or more than 50% of the vote. In that case, the president may appoint a prime minister who can test his majority on the floor, and the one who gets more than 50% majority forms the government. Next is, after the dissolution of Lok Sabha, he or she can ask the leader of the other party to prove its majority. This also I've already explained that in case the Lok Sabha is dissolved, the leader of the opposition party or any other party which has majority of the votes can test their leadership and can form the government. And he may also dismiss ministers from the Council of Ministers in certain circumstances. Yes, President appoints the Council of Ministers, but at the same time he can also remove them if the circumstances demand the same. So these are all discretionary powers exercised by the President, independent and sometimes on the advice of the Prime Minister and the Council of Ministers. Now, let us see what are emergency powers. Emergency powers are exercised when the situation in the country is disturbed or interrupted due to the following. That is, national emergency is declared when the country is in the state of war or there are internal disturbances or armed rebellion. So at that time, the normal functioning is not possible. And therefore, the complete control moves from the state government to that of the government of the country, and thus the country becomes or adopts a unitary form, that is all the powers vest with the government and also directly under the president. All the fundamental rights of the citizens during the national emergencies are suspended except the Article 20 and Article 21. So national emergency completely turns the country into a unitary structure, and the powers are exercised by the president on the advice of the prime ministers and the council of ministers. Second type of the emergency is the president's rule. Now these are the situations wherein there are disturbances in the functioning of a particular state or a union territory, and if that happens, the governor of the state can place a notice to the president, and the president, if is satisfied that the state government cannot control the functioning, he may take the charge, stating the president rule, that is the breakdown of constitutional machinery, and the complete control of the state, right from the financial resources to the electoral, judicial or executive powers, all of them vest with the president and is popularly called as president's rule. We see this happens many a times in case of Jammu and Kashmir when there are frequent riots or the peace or the public tranquility is disturbed completely. The president takes the charge of the particular state. And the next is financial emergency. Financial emergency is a situation where the financial system of the country is broken or the financial stability of the country is disturbed. So at that time, the financial resources cannot be placed with the state government, and all of the financial revenues and powers vest with the government and the president. And again, the country takes a unitary form. So all of these emergency powers are exercised by the president in the emergency situation, whether it be a national emergency, president's rule or financial emergency. And it shows that president is quite empowered to control the nation in such situations effectively. So here we saw different kinds of powers which vest with the president and which are stated in the Constitution of India. And henceforth we are going to move forward with another part, that is the Vice President of India. Now who is the Vice President of India? Vice President of India constitutionally is the ex officio chairman of the Rajya Sabha, means that one who is under the president, and he is the ex officio chairman means he is the one who presides over the Rajya Sabha and carries out the necessary functions of the Rajya Sabha. He is also elected by the members of Electoral College. His Electoral College consists of the members of both the houses of the parliament. It does not include the members of state legislative assemblies. Also, in the absence of president, vice president takes the charge And at that time, he is subjected to all the duties and powers which the president has. And also, he gets all the salary and emoluments which a president receives. Thus, vice president plays a very essential role in the country by performing its functions in the Rajya Sabha and also taking up the charge in the absence of president. Now, let us move ahead with the qualifications of the vice president. The qualifications to the election of a vice president are as follows. He and she must be a citizen of India. He should be at least 35 years of age. He or she should be qualified to be a member of Rajya Sabha, and he she should not hold any office of profit under the government. So here you can see that all the qualifications are same as that of the president except one. In case of president, the candidate should be qualified to be a member of Rajya Sabha, and in case of vice president, he should be or she should be qualified to be a member of Rajya Sabha, that is the Council of States. Now, the term of office, the president holds the office for a period of 5 years from the date he enters his office, and he may resign prior to the completion also by submitting his resignation with the president. And in case the position of the president becomes vacant due to illness or due to death of the president or his resignation or impeachment, the vice president takes up the charge. So here we see that constitutionally, both the president and the vice president play a very important role in holding the democratic setup, and they time to time exercise their powers to ensure the functioning of the parliament and the lawmaking business and to promote the welfare objective of the nation. So here I conclude the chapter and the topic, the president and the vice president. I hope we are now clear with what are the roles, functions, the qualification, the oath and term, and the positions of the president and the vice president with respect to the constitution. In case of any doubt, you can mention them in the comment section. And I appreciate that many students have come up with their doubts in the previous videos. And I would really encourage other students to do the same. I just want to say that keep studying and keep growing. And do like, subscribe and share the channel for further videos. Also mention in the comment section if there is any particular topic you want us to make videos on. And thank you and enjoy your lockdown productively. Take care.